As you know, in our new format, we wanted to bring speakers from all kinds of fields, and some of them had nothing to do with technology. But it was really important, and I still think it's very important in our daily lives to expand our collective brain and see that the world is bigger than Silicon Valley, and the issues we're dealing with are bigger than the technology of the company we just deal with day in and day out. But we also couldn't ignore some deep issues about technology when it can change your lives in the ways we don't expect. And I asked my two colleagues and friends, Reese and Eric, to go deep into those issues and make us think about what we invest into now, what technologies we work with now. And you know, Reese, you've seen him yesterday. It's Reese, like, working in encyclopedia. And Eric has invested all over the world. And some technologies which will not be obvious that they will be changing the industries at the time when he invested in them. And with that, the floor is yours. Talk to each other and really enjoy your conversation. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Reese Jones, and this is Eric Benamoun, and we've been in the internet plumbing infrastructure business since it began, basically. And one of the things, we sort of changed the pace into more of a fireside chat, and a little bit touch on some of the dark sides of technologies that have been evolving all this time. And that just as there's a good side about things, there's can be a darker side. And some of these things are genuine dilemmas that there isn't a clear right answer to. There might be a emotional or political opinion about one side or the other, but as a whole, they're unresolved issues that hopefully we'll touch on some of those. So, and thus sort of a lighter side, darker side, open for discussion. And so we want this to be a bit of a chat and an interaction. And so Eric just was recently at the RSA Security Conference and has been sort of deeply studying the security side of the internet and on the safety side. And the same week in San Francisco as the RSA security people were downtown, the hacker people were at Fort Mason, where I was. And so the same time, sort of both sides of the crowd were in town. And people are friends and generally cooperative and working on the same kind of internet, but from different points of view. So Eric, you want to touch on sort of these areas, what you could?
Sure, it's a good place to start because I think everybody understands that cybersecurity has two sides, and most people have been exposed to this perhaps very personally because they've been the victims of cyber attacks. But certainly, you've heard about, everybody has heard about some major hacks perpetrated all over the world. So when we talk about dark side, it's appropriate to talk about the dark web. So. Most of us here are accustomed to surfing the web, searching the web using your favorite search engine, typically Google, but there are others. And what we see of the web is not the entire web. Google does not index every single website that exists. There are things on the web that are addressable. If you send a packet to that particular address, it'll get there. Plumbing infrastructure that we help to build will make sure it gets there. But it will not be searchable. In other words, this is really a dark aspect of the web, which exists very much like in cities, where you have undergrounds, tenderloin districts, dark quarters. That same paradigm exists on the web. And usually, the sites which are part of the dark web are not really good sites. this is the sites that bad actors choose to use to communicate, to launch attacks, and to do business with each other. Because these are not lone actors, these are actors who collaborate together. So the dark web is not something that we can ignore. Anybody who's serious about doing threat intelligence has to start with understanding what's happening in the dark web. So, any one of us would be surprised to see what kind of things are being plotted. Recently I had this experience. I was talking to an entrepreneur who specialized in this, and said, let's do a little test. We have these tools which help explore the dark web. It's not a Google search. These are crawling systems that figure out what's happening in ways that are very difficult to do. Let's test who else has access to your domain name. So we're a venture firm in Silicon Valley, like there are hundreds of others. Our domain name exists in multiple places. Slightly different. There's a typo here, there's a little hyphen here that very few people would detect. Very, very different. Clearly, there's no one who would register the domain Ben and Global Ventures, the name of my firm, with a hyphen in the middle, unless they were up to something really bad. Well, that exists in three places, somewhere in Asia. I was not completely surprised, but I was stunned that we're able to find this so quickly. So there are tools available to basically understand threat intelligence and remediate some of these threats. But that's basically an illustration of the fact that you have a benign web where we conduct e-commerce, do business, and do social network stuff. And then you have a dark web where you do very, very bad stuff. Yeah, this is where you launch DDoS attacks. This is where you try to bring down companies. This is where you try to steal credit card numbers and PII information and so on. And that's this is part and parcel of what we created 20 years ago.
Yeah, so it's that most people assume that if you Google something, you're Googling everything that's on the internet. But Google indexes only a tiny fraction of what's on the internet and what, and only the parts that are visible. There are many parts that Google doesn't index for just commercial reasons that nobody's that interested in it. And other things are behind firewalls, and other things you have to interrogate the actual address to find out what it is, if it'll even tell you. And many times you have to say it in just the right way for it to even respond. So the larger portion of the internet is largely invisible to what we think of as what we see when we look in a browser or use a search engine. And there's among the kinds of bad things that have happened that are changing the whole culture of the internet and privacy and security and so forth is recently the U.S. government's Office of Personnel has a database of all of the people who work for the government, of which is more than 20 million of, and they fill out detailed questionnaires, including for those seeking security clearance. They go through lie detector tests, and the answers to their questions of the darkest parts of their life, while attached to a lie detector, those answers are in this database that is supposed to be at the highest level of security. So every employee in the NSA and the CIA and military intelligence and the FBI and so forth, their personal records of their most intimate and private things that they were required to disclose to get security clearance were in this database, and somebody hacked that database and got access to all 26 million records with all the answers to all the questions. So essentially, everybody in security intelligence for the government, maybe a few exceptions, but almost everybody in intelligence, their most personal vulnerabilities and secret answers are in the public now. Now, none of this has popped up as who actually has this database or how many different entities has this database, but essentially anybody who works in security on behalf of the U.S. government, in a sense, can be blackmailed with their history if they're in a compromising situation. So since this hasn't been used, it means that odds are rather sophisticated entities have this data, but it also, people who work in the security industry or for the government can't be very sanctimonious because their personal secrets are out in the open too. And so it's changed the whole nature of what it means, security and privacy, for the people who work on both protecting security and privacy and trying to research it for national security reasons or criminal reasons or business reasons and so forth. So the and that's just a hack that's been publicly disclosed and is widely known. But there's similar things for pretty much every government and every corporation. And the vast majority of these things are never disclosed that a breach has occurred, or in many cases, the keepers of the data have no idea that their data has been compromised. And this is an area that the industry of cybersecurity and cyber warfare has started to become more commercial and sophisticated in that trying to manage this, I wouldn't use the word protect it, but manage it is now an evolving thing. And one of the ways that it's evolving is instead of doors and keys and sort of command and control layers of security, the evolution seems to be more like an immune system where this is normal behavior, this is abnormal behavior or abnormal access. If that's happening, shut it down and then investigate why it's happening. And I wonder, Eric, if you'd like want to point out any particular strategies that are working commercially?
Well, the next several years, it's pretty clear to me, will be devoted to correcting a bad design assumption that dates back to the foundation of the internet, which is that people would be highly collaborative and would have benign intents. On that basis, we created a basically an insecure network, and we figured it would be, this would be what people want. And we did not, or we considerably underestimated the power that bad actors can have in this environment. So for the next several years, we're going to basically figure out ways to build up or rebuild our security and privacy space that has been badly in retreat for ever since the internet became a worldwide phenomenon. So there are attempts that suggest that it can be done. Some of you may be familiar with the Tor onion router, which basically creates an encrypted overlay over the existing internet that enables collaborating machines to communicate in an encrypted fashion. We rebuild some notion of privacy and security. There are many, many young companies who are figuring out ways to elegantly wrap encrypted tunnels around all of our communications. We walk around with smartphones and tablets and so on, and we communicate with our enterprise networks. Usually, that communication is not secure. You may have a VPN of some sort, but it's not really secure. In fact, when you connect your tablet or your smartphone, or your laptop, your enterprise network, any of that stuff that you have gathered on your device, basically, gets exposed to your enterprise data center. So this is how viruses get spread and infects enterprises. So increasingly, companies are thinking about ways to, at a very fine-grained level, secure your communication, your applications to your enterprise network, such that whatever you want to do, look up your customer record, look up a patient's patient data, look up supply chain information, all of this will be shrouded in a secure tunnel without affecting anything else that you have on your device. So these sort of tools are becoming more and more available and will become commonplace. Today, when we browse the web on our favorite device, we use a very open, unsecure browser. This will change. I think this will change within the next 5 years. You mentioned earlier that governments and enterprises are beginning to collaborate to fight against attackers. I think it's inevitable. This is the only way to make up for the asymmetry of cyber attackers, cyber defenders. The defenders have to collaborate. This is true in classical terrorism. This is true in cyber terrorism. The question is, if company A has been attacked and wants to warn company B of the attack and its symptoms and how it's propagates and so on, how can it do that? It's not appropriate to use a classical social network to collaborate. You have to create a secure network that enables enterprises, individuals, and governments to collaborate and organize their cyber defense. So we see a lot of companies who have figured out ways to do that. We're creating basically the equivalent of a highly secure sort of social network to mount collaborative cyber defense strategies.
And so I look at this from coming from a biology point of view or a biophysics point of view, in that our own bodies have an immune system, and our immune system has to defend against infections and cancers. And infections are like internet intrusions, and cancers are like users who have become rogue in some way and are doing something inappropriate. And so both of these are variations from normal, and our immune system responds to local variations to normal. But there is no central command and control that's a local phenomenon. It's part of biology, and it works kind of the same in all biological species. And so the parallel, Juan touched on the kind of parallel between biology and computers and how in both cases it's pretty much code of a complex system and a complex network and an internet, or a complex system like an ecosystem that has many species and they're mixed together. And we want to turn this into a bit more of an interactive conversation. So on the screen right now is a picture of most of the routers on the internet over a 24-hour period. And if you'll notice, the red is busy and hot, and blue is quiet and sleeping. So this is pretty much a movie of the internet being asleep and awake in different parts of the world. And so it's cycling across where the sun is, and when the people are locally awake and working and busy doing things, the routers are very busy and proactive. And in the blue areas, if you look closely, you'll notice occasional yellow and red spots in the blue areas. And the blue is the internet pretty much dreaming. And the little bits of activity while it's streaming are things like the Google data center synchronizing or YouTube updating across data centers across the world. And so it works in much the same way as human brains waking and sleeping, in that there's different modes of interaction. And we think of ourselves as mostly awake, but a third of the time we're sleeping. And so some of the activity that's going on in sleeping is evaluating our memories of the day and deciding whether they should be synchronized in our memory database or not, and purging those things that are inconsistent. It's a different kind of view of security. If somebody said something to you today that doesn't fit with your framework of life, cry tonight in your dream, you'll maybe have a bad dream about that and purge it from your framework of the world. And so the internet needs to evolve kind of a way of normalcy, of accepting data and purging data and blocking things that are inconsistent. And so this concept of the biological nature of how the internet works is a way of thinking about the complexity of it. And the internet, people underappreciate that the internet is made up of components, and at least a billion of those components are full-on awake human beings. And so the internet itself is half biological and half electronic, but it's one system, and it's operating as kind of a hybrid system of biology and electronics. And at the other end of that, it is us on our phones, where our phones are getting more sophisticated and more connected to the internet and to us. And essentially, if we're each a cell in a brain of the internet, and we have a phone as our synapse between the larger brain and ourself, and so in a sense, we're behaving like neurons in a brain. And we have our own thoughts, and our phone tells us what the collective is thinking, but we may not, as an individual cell, understand the larger consciousness and thought processes that are going on in the internet. So I think we have some other things we can talk about in some detail, but these kind of concepts, does anybody have any comments or thoughts or questions?
So as one of those people that was hacked on the OPM database, I was a little bit, you know, irritated. They sent us all out a little thing that said, you know, watch out, and, you know, we'll give you counseling or something like that if your life is destroyed. You know, hacking is one thing, but, you know, what a lot of us are wondering about is this whole question of encryption. You know, yeah, somebody can steal the data, but can they read it? So was that data encrypted, or why wasn't it encrypted, and how good is encryption? So, you know, is that part of the puzzle here?
It's part of the puzzle, but the puzzle is richer than that. The vast majority of us don't even bother encrypting things. I suspect that very few of you use an encrypted email system, even though these things exist. However, after you've been hacked a few times, you start to take measures, and you start to accept the bite of technology, which is the title of the session. Encryption is a highly asymmetrical technology in the sense that it's relatively easy to encrypt. However, if you don't have a key to decrypt, it may take you multiple lifetimes, particularly if you use today's standards like AES 256. There's not enough compute power in the world today to be able to crack an encrypted text, an encrypted cipher, without the key, not in relevant time frame. The problem that that we face is that I think it's illustrated by the current Apple versus FBI debate. on the one hand, if you really want to augment your privacy, you have to use these techniques. Because truly, if it's well encrypted, the encrypting part itself is unbreakable. You can figure out ways to break into it, as the FBI successfully did using these consultants, these Israeli consultants who broke into the iPhone. But they did not break the encryption. The encryption is, from the computer science perspective, unbreakable in practical terms. You can still figure out ways into this, but this is through the edges, not through the encryption part. The crux of the debate is, as I'm sure all of us have read, is it appropriate to have back doors of any kind? And all of us in the technology industry understand that all back doors can eventually mm-hmm. be found. There's no such thing as a back door only for this government. First of all, it is business suicide if you do that. But secondly, it's illusory. On the other hand, if governments have absolutely no way of breaking into these communications, it severely restricts our ability to mount counterterrorism efforts. So, personally, I found that the Snowden incidents of 3 or 4 years ago really took us back many, many years in our fight against terrorism. Because after 9/11, in the wake of 9/11, several programs were put in place under congressional approval, not to spy on people, but to collect metadata on people's conversations. And these programs highly augmented our anti-terrorism efforts. They didn't tell us what people were talking about, but they told us that this person is speaking to that person. We know this person is a bad one. Therefore, that person may actually also be a bad one. And it focuses search efforts in a way that saves an incredible amount of resources. And all this metadata collection, because of the broad public impact it has, basically was stopped, and I think this probably wiped out several years of counterterrorism efforts. So when we talk about budget of technology, I believe that all this metadata collection was a legitimate way to mount collaborative anti-terrorism efforts without breaking into people's privacy. But we've taken a step back, and I think over time, for the next 9/11, I think it will inevitably resurface and be adopted, perhaps in a slightly different way, but I think it's inevitable. What's interesting is that while we talk about this today in the public media, back in the 90s, the government was, the Defense Department of the government was asking all the internet equipment providers to standardize on an encryption chip. Some of you may remember the Clipper chip. This was an encryption chip that was used between routers to conduct encrypted communication with a backdoor available to the government. At the time, it was a hotly contested debate. It was eventually rejected, but it had absolutely no impact on the broad public. Because these were pre-smartphone days. It only concerned the communication between routers. People barely understood what this plumbing was doing and didn't really care. Whereas today, if the pipe terminates all the way to your device, it has a personal impact on you that generates high emotions. So, I think I speak on behalf of the broad technology industry. We don't like backdoors because we know they can be broken. On the other hand, we have to develop technologies around